You want to open your Bible with me this morning to John chapter 16, verse 33. John chapter 16, verse 33. John 16, verse 33. Are we all there?
Yeah.
All right. I've told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. Also, we are going to read from Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. Galatians chapter 2, verse 20. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me, who gave himself for me. Today, I'm going to be sharing with you, I am designed robust. Everybody say that. I'm going to say it again. I am designed to be robust. See that? Thank you, Father. This morning, the entrance of your word giveth light and understanding to the simple. As your word proceeds from the mouth of this little man, I pray that you cause your word to find its place in the heart of your children. None of us here will go away without being touched by the power of the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Father. I release your presence into this atmosphere. When this word is proceeding, the entire community of UH campus will partake in that divine presence right now in the name of Jesus Christ. I suspend every activity contradictory to God right now at this very moment in the next 4 hours. Thank you, Father. Jesus' name we have declared. Have your seat confidently. All right. I am designed robust. Everybody say that confidently. What is the meaning of robustness? What's the meaning of robustness? The quality of being strong and healthy despite being subjected to adverse conditions. I'll repeat myself. The quality of being strong and healthy despite being subjected to adverse conditions. It also can be said to be the ability to withstand or overcome adverse conditions or rigorous testing. Hallelujah. So that means robustness is survival in the midst of confusion. Christ was confidently telling us that it's not our home. Our home belongs to heaven. So he has prepared us as sheep in the midst of wolves. Everybody say, in the midst of wolves. So he was subject to then having us designed robustly so that we can be able to stand in the midst of ravening wolves. God did not design us to be goats in the midst of wolves, but he designed us to be sheep, because a sheep has a shepherd. A goat has no shepherd. A goat does what he pleases. So God designed us as a sheep to be able to stand in the midst of wolves, because he knows it was time to be the shepherd. Now we're going to clarify something here. How does God design us to be robust? We're going to clarify that first before we talk about why God designed us to be robust. How does he design us to be robust? Why does he design us to be robust? Number one, how does God design us to be robust? Number one, he saved us. That was the first step. Ephesians chapter 2 verse 8 to 11 says, Ephesians chapter 2 verse 8 to 11 says, for by grace you are saved through faith, And that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, verse 9, not of works, lest anyone should boast, verse 10. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared, everybody say prepared, beforehand that we should walk in them. So we've been prepared. We've been saved by Christ. We've been designed by him. We've been predestinated to be saved by Christ. So the first thing God knew he was going to do was to offer himself as a sacrifice so that we can all be saved. That's men that confess him as the Lord Jesus Christ, he will forsake their sin. If they confess their sin, they will never think of their sin anymore. And the word said, the word of God said in the book of Hebrew, I will put their sin into no remembrance anymore. First step, second step. How does God design us to be robust? He washed us with washing of water by his word. Not only saving us, he cleans our hearts. In the book of Ezekiel chapter 36 verse 25, where he made a promise exactly, he said, then I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean. And I will cleanse you from all your filthiness and from all your idols. That's an interesting promise that Jesus came to make upon us. That means we are not going to be like those ones in the Old Testament that they need to call priests and all sorts of people to come and help us get close to God, wash us from all our filthiness. But now say we have the liberty to freely go to the throne of grace to obtain mercy because we've been washed by his blood. Everybody say we are washed by his blood. Not only by his blood, we are washed by water, which is the washing of the word of God. Hallelujah. The washing of the what? Word of God. God has designed us to be robust. He saved us. He washed our heart clean to be clean, to have clear communication and fellowship with him. Number three. How does God design us to be robust? He pours his spirit down on us. And he asked the spirit to write his law in our hearts. Not only that, guide us into truth. Not only that, comfort us. Not only that, help us. Hallelujah. What an interesting grace we have. God said, I have designed you to be robust. Because I'm going to send my spirit unto you that's going to make you to be robust enough in the midst of wolves. What are the work of the Holy Spirit? Number one is to help us. Number two is to comfort us. You can see the terror that a sheep can face in the midst of wolves. So therefore, God knows that we need to have comfort. In the campus like this, we have all days, all our field up with coursework. Busy here and there. You go to work, you go to look for ways to make money to support yourself. You also need to study to get your GPA up. You also have a career to pursue. A lot of interesting pressure all over there. But Jesus said, I understand all your aches, all your headaches, all your fears, all your concerns, all your challenges. That's why I'm sending my spirit upon you to be able to stand in the midst of all these stresses. Not only that, there are spiritual fighters who want you to achieve your goal in life. We wrestle not against the flesh and blood, but against principalities and power. Against all those men that are raised by the devil, be with the devil in the high places. Christ understands that. He said, I am going to send my spirit upon you. You need to be designed robust. Everybody say robust. When you land on the floor, you will wake up. Hallelujah. As David said, I fall, seven times have I fall, but I rose again. Hallelujah. You land on the floor, you rose again. They shoot you an arrow, you defend yourself. Hallelujah. Robust design. Everybody say robust design. Jesus said, I send my spirit to you for what purpose? To write my law into your heart, to make you to remember my law. Praise the Lord. Jesus was very specific. He said, for the Holy Spirit will remind you all things. Amen. It will guide you into truth. Hallelujah. I said, there's some things that I've told you, but I've not even told you. He said, those things, the Holy Ghost, when I leave, shall bring those things into you. Hallelujah. It will bring those things into your remembrance, all that I've taught you. That is a powerful work. Hallelujah. That means reading the Bible is not to be understood by the flesh. Reading the Bible is meant to be understood by the Spirit that He said He was going to send to us. That means reading the Bible is not meant to be kept in the brain. Reading the Bible is meant to be kept in the heart. The word have I kept in my heart so that what? I will not sin against you. Who is the memory man that help us to remember all those things that the Lord has said? And what the Lord has not said at all is the Holy Spirit. Everyone say, Holy Spirit. What a robust design. One has a spiritual intelligence that has nothing to do with the brain. Wonderful. Robust design. That means in the midst of confusion, you can wake up and know what to do. Hallelujah. That is what the Holy Ghost is doing. It's robustly preparing us for future challenges. To stand as a representative of God on earth. Hallelujah. Not only that, that our light might be shining unto the world. That people can see our work and glorify God who is in heaven. Are you following me? Robust design. Number four. He decided to be with us always, wherever we step our feet upon. Wow. In the book of Matthew, chapter 18, verse 28, he was able to make that clear. Hallelujah. Also, John, chapter 14, verse 17. And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. The Spirit of Truth. The Word. Hallelujah. Listen carefully. The world cannot accept him. Wow. That's what made the church different from the world. Any gathering that have no acceptance of the Holy Spirit is termed as the world. Amen. Hallelujah. It doesn't matter how heavy they call the name of God. It does not matter how celebrated is the praise of God. But when the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is denied, then such gathering is termed as a gathering that belongs to the world. It's a gathering of the flesh. Amen. The Bible says we walk not by the flesh, but by the Spirit. Hallelujah. It says as many that are led by the Holy Ghost, they are the sons of God. So the church is a place where the children of God gather because of what? Because of the Holy Spirit that is accepted in their midst and is celebrated in their midst. Now listen carefully. Because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him. Everybody say, I know Jesus. I know the Holy Spirit. For he lives with you. Now listen carefully. Emmanuel. That's an interpretation of Emmanuel. Jesus, in the Old Testament, Jesus was for them. But in the New Testament, not only that Jesus, God is for us, but God is also with us, Emmanuel. God is also in us. Go for that. He said, and you, it will be in you. Hallelujah. What a triple honor. Amen. We say triple honor. In the Old Testament, they need to cry to the priest to help them out on some things. To wash away their sins. To have a consolation. To have all sorts of things they need from God. But you know what? In the New Testament, we are now freely able to go to the throne of grace to obtain mercy. What a robust design. Hallelujah. I don't need a priest to help me reach God. What a robust design. Hallelujah. I can knock at God's door and enter the gate of heaven and speak to God. Hallelujah. What a robust design. It means when I have trouble around me, I can cry upon the Lord and the Lord can answer me. What a robust design. It means no enemy can capture me. What a robust design. It means no sin can take me away from God. What a robust design. Hallelujah. Now, why does God design us robust? Number one, Christ understands that there is a need for self-denial from our own personal comfort. Why is God doing all this design? Why has God made us like this? Why are we not just like the world? Why can we not just doing things the way the world are doing their own thing? Why? Because God knows we need to deny ourselves. Now see where it confirms that. God is not saying that you're going to do all these things by your strength. He said, I'm designing you robust to be able to go through this fulfillment. Then you will be my true servant, steward, child. Luke chapter 9, verse 58 to 62. Luke chapter 9, verse 58 to 62. And Jesus said to him, foxes have holes, birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. Oh, wow. The creator of the heavens and the earth. He goes around with the Bible and preaching the gospel. Nothing deters his movement. Nothing stops him from proclaiming Christ. Nothing was so important more than the preaching of the gospel. He has no house. Hallelujah. Even though he has a house. Wonderful. A denier. Christ is asking for our generation. Our generation today, we do not want to deny anymore. We don't want to deny what is so comfortable to us. We don't want to sacrifice. He said, present yourself as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. Because it is a reasonable service. Reasonable service. Come on. It's not even the full service. It's reasonable. Other things are not reasonable. Hallelujah. It means when we come to church like this, we're not just only sitting down to listen. We are fanning into action. Like the disciples who deny everything around them and root for the gospel. Everybody root for the gospel. They preach the gospel with all their might, with all their mind, with all their heart, with all their soul. Christian people. They were not proclaiming themselves, but they were proclaiming Jesus, the author and the finisher of their faith. And the people of the world had no choice. They were listening to them. Hallelujah. See, one cannot get one what one does not invest in. Hallelujah. That's not going to be a reward for no sowing. Hallelujah. We have to sow denial for men to have a time to listen to what we are saying. If I'm ministering to people and I've not taken my time to pray, to deny myself in fasting and get ready for the people and respect the people, because sometimes it's a disrespect. When I take my microphone, I never fasted. I never prepared. I just went lackadaisical. I begin to preach to the people. Number one, I've disrespected them. Number two, I've disrespected the power of God. And so when people don't listen to me, then it's my problem. Hallelujah. Not their problem. Hallelujah. So God wants us to deny ourselves. Sometimes we need to keep away from food. Amen. We have food in abundance in America. Everybody eats. Everybody what? Eats. The student I'm teaching, oh my God, if you say, whenever we first finish this particular exercise, I will give you a little bit of chocolate. You know what? They will finish quickly. Hallelujah. Because they are inclined to eating. Amen. It's an environment of eating. Amen. We eat a lot. Amen. We have consumerism in America. Hallelujah. We consume everything. Hallelujah. We consume what? But God wants us to deny sometimes. Away from our consumerism. Deny ourselves. Stand alone with Christ in one corner. Speak to God about the souls of the people. Behave as if you have no house, even though you have a house. Sometimes you need to move away from your hostel. Walk the street and begin to pray. All this guy, Lord. These people, all over the campus, serving demons. Amen. Hallelujah. You don't believe that people are serving, some people are serving demons? It's real, right? Who strap themselves naked in the name of courts, you know they are serving demons already. But you are looking and say, that's the way of life. That's global effects. That's the millennium walk. On the what? On who's bringing the millennium walk? And we close our mouths and we refuse to do nothing. And God is saying, look at my children. Look at this one I've appointed. I've designed robustly. What are they doing? I've given them power to tread upon serpents. Whatever they lay their hand upon shall prosper. I've given them power that will, even if they take a deadly thing to drink, it will not hurt them. Why are they afraid of these people? Why are they not shouting out and speak about me? God is crying. Jesus is weeping and say, will my death be in vain? God has designed us robustly. We need to take our position. Stand for the Lord. Get out of our porch. Get out of our comfort zone. And move closer to God. Hallelujah. 59. Then he said to another, follow me. But he said, Lord, let me first go and bury my father. Verse 60. Jesus said to him, let the dead bury their own dead. You would think Jesus is not compassionate here. Doesn't care about dead people. Your kids. But one thing is more important. It's about the gospel. Amen. The gospel offer power to raise the dead. There was this man called, he's already dead, right? A great man of God. And he came across a particular portion of the scripture. That's how his ministry started. When he came up, particular scripture said, they will lay their hand upon the dead and will arise. When he came upon that particular verse in the scripture, he went ahead. He roaming about the street, moving from one home to the other. And luckily, he got this particular burial ceremony. And they said, somebody is already there. And they are trying to bury. And he just entered there. Can you give me permission to touch this casket? And he went there. They said, go ahead. As he touched this casket, the dead body rose. Hallelujah. What a wonderful God. Amen. They were busy burying people. Amen. But the gospel is busy reviving people. The gospel is a reviver. The gospel is what? Getting committed to. Hallelujah. Than getting committed to burial ceremony. The gospel is much power than your worries. The gospel is much power than your concerns. God can take care of your concerns if only we can deny ourselves. We have been designed robust to be able to deny ourselves. We have the potential. We have the power. The Holy Ghost is in us. He can help us to achieve the goal. Hallelujah. And another said, Lord, I will follow you. But let me first go and bid themselves farewell who are at my house. You know what I'm saying? God wants to detach you from old friends. You want to go and seek connection. Let me find a landing ground, a balancing point before I can now give my life to you. Hallelujah. Let me tell you, the friend will turn you against Christ. Hallelujah. God said, stop it. Come to me. No need to look back. Bible said, whoever lay his hand upon the plow and look back. And what? And look back. It's not fit for the kingdom. You're saying you're going to say farewell to your colleagues. Farewell to your whole friend. There's friend of sin. A friend of unrighteousness. It is time for us to move by self-denial and take a responsibility and take a focus and stop deceiving ourselves. Because, we have all sorts of things going on that will make our brain be swollen, right? And Christ has not come over here to make our brain swollen. Christ has come over here to make our heart swollen. Amen. A big heart. Everybody say a big heart. The way it did to Solomon. I would say God enlarged the heart of Solomon. God has the habit of enlarging people's heart, not enlarging people's head. God is not a God of head wisdom, but a wisdom that resides in the heart. The Holy Ghost resides in the heart of man, not in the head. Stop going to places where they will give you words. Well-arranged philosophical words. That Apostle Paul said, he said, this gentle unto destruction. He said, the gospel is not by word only, by word of man only. It's by power. Hallelujah. The Bible says, he said, in the later day, he said, having ears that is inching, they will prefer what they want to hear. Hallelujah. And they will deny the power of in the word of the, I mean, in the power of the word, the power in the word of God. And they will concentrate on those words that has no power. Hallelujah. Jesus said in the book of John, chapter 6, verse 63, if I'm right. He said, flesh profit nothing. But the word I speak to you is the spirit and life. That means God is the one that actually can feed the heart of human being. Philosophy cannot feed your heart. They will only get you drunk in the brain. Just as you take a wine. And the wine turn your mind of your head around, and you be able, and you are able to be honestly confident, and you have a temporary comfort, and after the drunkenness is gone, you're back to your sorrow. Hallelujah! But when the Holy Ghost is in charge, what does He do? He goes to the source. Where is the source? The heart of human being. Amen. The heart of what? A human being, and He fills you up and He transforms you by His word. And then your heart will be able to control your head. Amen. God has robustly designed us for our heart to control our head, not for our head to control our heart. Hallelujah. Give not yourself unto the control of the flesh, which is your brain. Deny yourself. Hallelujah. Number two. Why has Christ designed us robust? Number two. Because Christ understands that we cannot carry our cross with human muscle. Wow. He understands that this is impossible. Even in during the time he was about to be crucified, remember, he was about to deny Christ. I mean, to deny God. He was saying, "If I wish this cup could pass over me, but not my will, but your will be done." Where is the will coming from? Where is the will of God coming from? He's handing over the direction of his life unto the hand of the Holy Ghost in him. Hallelujah. Oh, that's the way we have been designed. We are designed to hand over our decision making, hand over our direction, hand over our will to the hand of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. To the hand of what? Holy. Let me tell you, there are so many interesting things going on. If we want to get busy with the world, we have more than enough to get us busy. Hallelujah. More than enough. If you want to get easy job, just join courts. Amen. Amen. I was in campus those days. I was invited. I said it one time. I said, okay, be in this particular court society. It's an engineering court. So all you need to, we initiate you. I've initiated you. What's going to happen is this. After a while in life, you go to, they told me personally, and then you're going to be giving signal. Everybody you see in a corporate office, you can also give the signal. They're members. You get a job easily. Hallelujah. But that's not what God is want to give to us. What God wants to give to us is permanent. It's more than what God can give. Amen. It's what more than what man can give. It's what he himself gives. He said, the blessing of God makes rich without having sorrow with it. Hallelujah. Self-denier, looking forward to Christ and making sure that we know that we are robustly designed is the way forward. Hallelujah. Am I offending somebody today? Hallelujah. The Holy Ghost will comfort your soul if I've offended you. The Holy Ghost will give you clear vision if I've offended you. Just allow me to speak this word, because it told me this is the word you are going to speak to my people. You are going to emphasize the truth. Don't put your own ideas. Don't put your own philosophy. Just read my Bible. Just allow the Holy Ghost to interpret my word to you. Speak to them. I'm the owner of heart of human being. I know how to take care of their heart. Those who are mine will listen to me. Those who are not mine will not listen. Hallelujah. I know you are of God and you are listening. Hallelujah. He knows we can't do things by our muscle. Luke chapter 14, verse 27. Luke 14, 27 says, "And whoever does not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple." Wow. Self-denier. Interesting. Is it a gospel, really? Sometimes I just look at it. Let's look at it in a perspective of generality of what we've experienced so far. Can this be true that we are not qualified to be a child of God, to be a disciple? If we do not deny ourselves, there's a serious issue here. What are we doing in ages? We've been telling people, oh, feel good, as the song does sound, right? Feel good, you can do better, you're going to get better. No, it only gets better when Christ comes in. Hallelujah. When Christ is in the show, that's when it gets better. It's going to get worse. You know what the devil does? He gives us preoccupation all the time. You get preoccupied and you're going to get better. 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 And peace is lacking. The more they get better, the more the peace is withdrawn. The more we are fighting too much. The more we are struggling hard to make both ends meet. Wow. What a business that the devil creating people. But God is saying, my friend, I need you to deny. If you can deny yourself, I'll take care of you. Amen. Say, I will take care of you. He asked us to be sheep. Not goats. Amen. You know, goat is more powerful than sheep physically. Amen. It's more powerful. See a knock of goat on a sheep, the sheep will fall down. But because the sheep has a shepherd. Amen. I am a good shepherd. Hallelujah. The sheep know me, and I know my sheep. When they hear my voice, they will listen. Amen. And they know I also understand their voice. Hallelujah. That's what Jesus said. He designed us robustly to be able to carry our cross. He understands how cross was heavy when it was the way to crucifixion. He knew that the cross was heavy for him. He knew that the people that will follow him, we have to be robustly designed so that they can carry their cross and body. Even though
God will put men.
We're not crying. Let me continue. The Second Corinthians chapter 6 that was read in the Bible reading. It was, even though we have proved ourselves as minister of God, even though we are crucified, but we refuse to be crucified. Even though we are poor, we still remain rich. Hallelujah. Second Corinthians chapter 6, from verse 2 to 10, right? 4 to 10. That's what I just read. Hallelujah. Sorry for being fast, because I've got to cover this message. Hallelujah. I got to release this to you, because once the seed is sown in your life, it goes with you. Amen. Years to come, this will become giant tree and bearing fruit. Hallelujah. Giant what? Tree and bearing fruit. If you want to see power, the word of God is power. The greatest miracle you can see in your life is the miracle of the word of God that offers deliverance. Amen. Episode is deliverance. The miracle of the word of God that gives wisdom. That's a powerful, the most powerful miracle you can ever get on the surface of the earth. If you want me to be a magician, I won't be able to be a magician. Hallelujah. But I will speak the word of God, and I allow the word of God to be a power over your life and activate your system and turn you around. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. John chapter. Matthew chapter 16, verse 24. Matthew 16, 24, 26. Matthew 16, verse 24, 26. Then said Jesus unto the disciples, if any man will come after me, listen carefully, let him deny himself. Everybody say what? Deny himself. Everybody say that. And take up his cross and follow me. Oh, oh, oh. 2.5 hours per week to serve the Lord. And we say we are busy. Is that a discipleship? 2.5 hours in a week. 2.5 hours. Everybody say 2.5 hours in a week. How many hours makes a whole week? Good mathematician. Huh? How do you calculate it? Tell us. Times what? Times 7. All right. And what's what? What's that? Mathematician. Come on. It's a lot of engineers here. Okay. Yeah. Out of those hours, wonderful. We can't spare 2.5 hours. And we say we are disciples, we are children of God, and we deny ourselves. No, no, no. But we can create time for movies. Movies, really. 5 hour movie at a row. I was in the student center. I was just passing by. I said, everybody was busy with a phone. That's one movie in the phone, another movie on the computer. I said, you just want high to watch movie on the phone, another high to watch movie on the computer, and then certain typing was going on the right. I said, Social media typing. Hallelujah. And then we said, we have no time to spend 2.5 hours in God's presence. Wow, wow, wow. What a deception of the devil. But we have been designed robust. Amen. We've been designed robust to withstand every discouragement on our way. We can tell the devil, go to hell. Everybody say, go to hell to the devil. We don't have a part in you. We want to be in the church. A church is a place to get power, to get fired up. Everybody say, fired up. Are you fired up? That's it. If a church can't offer fire, you need to leave right away. If this church becomes sluggish and we can't see God's presence, we'll shut it down. Go to my house and go sleep. Amen. What are we doing here? This is a place where God is present. I'm so confident. When he appeared to me in my dream, when I was in Arizona State University, doing my PhD, said, go ahead. I want my people towards me. Come back to me. I stopped my PhD. I got my master program. I'm in this. Hallelujah. I'm no longer afraid. I'm dead already. Amen. What do I say? I'm dead already. I don't take the work away anymore. I'm done with taking God's work as if it's mine. I'm done with that. Amen. You know, getting fatigued because of what God's work? No. No more. Amen. Everybody say, no more. Somebody get angry. All of you get angry and say, I'm not coming again. Good. Hallelujah. What do I say? That'll be replacement. Hallelujah. May God not replace you in the name of Jesus Christ. Okay, now, what do you see here? Some people have left, right? But are they replaced or not? God knows how to prepare people. It doesn't matter. Our decision can't change God. God can't be changed by the decision of man. God can only be changed by himself. And the Bible makes us to understand, it changes not. Amen. It changes what? No. We human being can change. We can say, I have a low GPA because I'm serving Christ. 2.5 hours in a week. You have a low GPA because of 2.5 hours you spend because God's presence. Oh, listen carefully. By God's grace, I happen to be the best student in my first degree, mechanical engineering. I was spending 12 hours a week to serve the Lord. How did I make it? And some people here in this church, right, they are having three GPA of 3.99, 3.78 in this fellowship. Hallelujah. Can God not help us? Can God not help us? God can help us. Hallelujah. Even if you have a low GPA, we have brothers and sisters here that can stand for you in the corner and pray to God. Lord, what is the problem? How can we resolve this? Help our brother. Help our sister. If you have a financial problem, there are brothers and sisters here. We enter into a room and pray with you. That's what we are together. We are family. And when we pray, what happens? God opens his heaven and responds to you. Our brother, do you have a testimony? He has a testimony. Yeah, I would like him to share a testimony all the time. What happened to you? He has an issue here in this campus, but God rise up to the situation. He informed us, we prayed. How many days we prayed? 3 days, right? And fasting and prayer. We cry out to God, and God resolved the whole thing and turned it around. Now he's here and moving on. Hallelujah. What are we talking about? The church of God is a place to get a joy, not to get sadness, not to get angry with God and run away and say, God is disturbing me. God is taking my hours too much. 2.5 hours is too much. I gotta go to theater to watch movie. I need a time to relax. That is when we treat Christianity as religion. Christianity is not a religion. Christianity is the way to live in. The way to live in. Not a way, but the way to live in. Everybody say the way to live in. Hallelujah. Amen. Let me just jump that quickly. Christ understand. Why is he designed us? What's the time? Oh, that's a lot of time. Hallelujah. Amen. A lot of time. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Why did Christ design us robustly? Number three, Christ understand that since he was persecuted and crucified, we will be persecuted and crucified with him. Wow. That's why he designed us. He get us ready for persecution of men. It's blessed are you when you are persecuted for righteousness' sake. Interesting. Wow. Wow. John chapter 15, verse 20. John 15, 20. Remember the word that I said unto you. A servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, Jesus Christ, they will also persecute you. Nobody wants to hear that. In a church? Telling me I'll be persecuted as a Christian? Hey. Everyone say, hey. People will not like what you're doing. They won't like you because you are different. You carry a symbol. They say, I bear upon me the mark of what? Mark of Christ. So when they see the mark of Christ upon your body, the way you are robustly designed, you are too ugly to the community that are not of Christ. You are a hard one out. You'll be seen as a unique person. Very many people will be jealous of you. You got to understand that you are different. The difference you created in the community is what makes people to persecute you. It's not your making. Hallelujah. When the disciples stood up to preach the gospel, we were told that they would rejoice because of the word of Christ was fulfilled. How? They were being persecuted. Amen. Yet they are having victory. That was the time one of them was locked up in a prison. And they enter the room, robustly designed. They enter the room, they cry unto God, Lord, where are the hiding range? And the people imagine the venting. And they began to cry. 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 Suddenly, the angel of God entered the prison and opened the door and said, Peter, walk out of this prison and go meet your brethren. Hallelujah. What a miracle of those days. Are we having that miracle these days? No way. Because we do not deny ourselves. We don't know who we are. The knowledge of who you are takes you to where you are going. Ignorance of what you are makes the enemy press over you. The Bible says, we are not ignorant of the device of the devil. Number four. Why did Christ design us robustly? Since Christ knows we are going to be offended. Ah. He designed us to be robust, to be generous forgivers and lovers of people, including those who do not even like us. Ah. How easy it is for me to love my enemy. It must have been an extra design in my life for me to have that passion, compassion, to love somebody who is pummeling me every day and hitting me up every day. And I had to develop love for those persons beyond likeness. Interesting. How is it is for a human being without the Holy Ghost, without robustness of design by God, to be able to do that? Not easy. But we have to be aware that God requires that we be forgivers. That way, we can bring many to the kingdom. He wants us to overlook. He said, look, I'm your father. I know this whole show. Okay? I know you're in the midst of wolves. I myself, I know the people I'm dealing with. I actually rain a rain upon everyone, even though they are my enemies. So why won't you let things go and just love these people and preach the gospel to them? And stop yelling on their name. That's what he's telling us. That's what he's telling us. Matthew chapter 5, verse 43. Matthew 5, 43 to 48. Ye have heard that it has been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thy enemy. Verse 44. But I say unto you, love your enemies. Woo-hoo. Oh my God. Bless them that curse you. This is serious. Do good to them that hate you. Ah. Now, go for that. Now, pray. Everybody say pray. For them which despitefully use you and persecute you. Ah. Excuses in the community of faith. Excuses. They took your job away. You begin to curse them. You enter to God's presence and report the situation to God and hand it over to God. Because a sheep has a shepherd. And the shepherd knows what to do when the sheep is tormented. You don't even need a part in this. No need to curse anybody. No need to hate anybody. All you got to do is to report the situation to God. Father, your son is crying. Father, I'm being tormented. Father, somebody's taking away my job. I did nothing. But they took away my job. That day, when I cry unto God, you were about to sack me. They give me a sack letter. Sign, see you, God. And I cry in that office. I say, Lord, if I've done very well here, I shed my blood in efficiently working, and you're sacking me here today, I said, the Lord will defend me. And I left. Hallelujah. Not quite long, in about 1 week or less than 1 week. Ha! A message came from another country. They said, look, there's somebody in your house. He is going through a situation right now. He said, he should not defend himself. He should just let it stay. But I, God, I will defend him. When we had a story, we were told that the person who was responsible for my sacking was completely sacked. Okay, the cup was transferred, hallelujah, and the good cup was brought back to me, hallelujah. Hallelujah. I don't make guess of the person, but I thank God today because God is a defender of those who are weak, hallelujah. You don't need to snap your teeth and carry your gun. You need to carry God. Amen. Everybody say, carry God. Forgive people. Forget about what they have done to you. Let it go. Move in the direction of God. God can defend you. God can defend you. He knows you are going to be offended. He has designed you robustly to be able to withstand all those offenses. Now let's look at the book. Let me continue with that verse. 45. That ye may be the children of your father. Look at it. 44. But I say to you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them that shall use you and pass you. 45, that ye may be children of your Father, which is in heaven. For he makes his son to rise on the evil, wow, on the good, and sendeth rain on the just and on the unjust. Verse 46, for if ye love them which love you, what reward have you? Do not even the publicans, the unbeliever, the world, do the same? 47, and if ye salute your brethren only, What do you more to others? More than the others. Do not even the public and the world, okay, do so. Verse 48. Be ye therefore perfect, even as your Father in heaven is what? Is perfect. Wow. That's upon your feet today. God is talking to us. He wants us to be connected to his robust design. The Bible says you are fearfully and wonderfully made to withstand pressure, to withstand challenges, to be able to move on in the midst of wolves, ravening wolves for that matter. God said, behold, I'm with you to the end of the world. God said, my Holy Spirit will be your comforter, your help. It will guide you into truth. Now speak to him. Father, I reclaim my position. I reclaim my rights. I reclaim my design. I assume my design. From now on, I am changed person. Begin to declare, I am changed person. I take hold of my design. I resume my design. I resume my position. I am moving forward from now. No more not forgiving people. No more hating people. No more not denying myself. I am moving forward from here. I am accepting you. I am crucified with you. I am crucified with you. The life that I now live is the life in Christ Jesus. Lord, I assume my position. Speak to God. Open your mouth. If you do not speak, God can't hear. You need to speak. When you speak, God will hear. God is waiting to hear from you. You are his son. You are his daughter. He loves you. He cares for you. He wants to hear you. Your word is very powerful to him. When you speak, he hears you. He listens. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Come on, speak to him. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. I take my position. I assume my position today. No longer will I be getting angry around. No longer will I not deny myself. No longer will I run away from you. I will stand for you. I will stay with you. I will embrace you. I will walk. I will not be afraid. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil because you are with me. Your spirit is with me. It guides me. It speaks to me. It leads me. It directs my path. It gives me comfort. It embraces me. It feeds me. It takes care of me. Holy Ghost, I take myself into you. I bring myself into knowledge of your faith. Lord Jesus Christ, let me not look back. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, with all declare. Mighty God of heaven will thank you. We present your children to you this morning. I have given your word the way you have ordered me. May you perfect all they have had. May you cause your word to have a ground in their heart. May you allow this tree to grow and bear fruit in their lives. May you open the eyes of your children, including me. May you help us to be able to fully represent you in this campus, to stand for you in the midst of dying generation and bring many to the fold of the kingdom. Thank you, Father, today, for you have answered. In Jesus' name, we have prayed.